last class, just at the end, Dikshit had asked a question which is a very relevant question. He wanted to know what is the relationship between humidity and temperature. To answer his question, I think we have to go to a basic relationship, because humidity is basically a function of vapor pressure. So we must have a standing and a proper understanding of what is the vapor pressure, how it changes the temperature, and that is the relationship which is influencing the effect of temperature on humidity as well. There is a relationship between the vapor pressure and temperature, and the relationship is named as psychrometric curve. Which looks something like this. If I express this vapor pressure in millibars, and on this side we have temperature. This relationship, this curve, is the envelope curve which gives us the saturation vapor pressure. But first of all, we have to know what is the difference between saturation vapor pressure and vapor pressure. Vapor pressure, as is defined, is the partial pressure exerted by the vapors at a particular location, and that partial pressure is called the vapor pressure. Now, to give you an example, if we have an air mass at this location, and this air mass, let me say that we are having an air mass which is in a controlled environment. This is a vessel which is a closed vessel. The air mass is in a closed environment, and this air mass is at some temperature. This air mass is at some temperature. This temperature is the temperature at which the air mass is temperature T here. Now, if you supply more energy, if you increase the temperature of this air mass by heating it up, the temperature of the air mass will go up. And with the temperature, the absorption capacity of the air mass will also go up. The air mass can absorb more moisture from this water, or you can see that this water, since you are supplying energy, it will be in a position to evaporate some of the moisture from this water, and that moisture will be going into the air mass. That will be increasing the vapor pressure of the air mass. To which extent this air mass can absorb, keep on absorbing more moisture, is defined by this psychrometric curve. This is the maximum level up to which it can absorb moisture. So as you keep on increasing the temperature, there is at a particular temperature, there is a corresponding vapor pressure which is known as the saturation vapor pressure. So this vapor pressure is the saturation vapor pressure, which is the vapor pressure corresponding to a particular temperature up to which the moisture can be absorbed. Beyond that, if you will try to try to ensure, if you try to heat it up further, there is a chance that, since in this particular case we are saying that the temperature is being controlled, we are looking at the same temperature. If the temperature is controlled, you are increasing the vapor pressure of the same air mass at the same temperature up to a level which is corresponding to a saturation vapor pressure. But if you change the temperature, then at a different temperature, the vapor pressure will be, the saturation vapor pressure will be different. So air mass can absorb more moisture if the temperature increases. But at a particular temperature, there is a capacity for the air mass to absorb moisture, and that capacity is known as saturation vapor pressure. So from that angle, is an important parameter which needs to be observed. Let's look at another aspect of the same thing. That now, if I am trying to reduce the temperature of the same air mass, I reduce the temperature from this level to this level. Now, the air mass is having some moisture availability at this particular temperature. When I reduce the temperature, what will happen? It will, the temperature will reduce to an extent that it will reach this level, which is the corresponding level at a temperature T2. If this is T1, at a temperature T2, corresponding to that temperature, there is a corresponding saturation vapor pressure. So if I try to reduce the temperature beyond this temperature, the condensation will take place, and that is what is known as dew point temperature. This is the dew point temperature, and at this temperature the condensation will take place. Now, this deficit is, this deficit between ES and EA, this is called the saturation deficit. The difference between ES and EA, this is known as the saturation deficit. This is an important factor which influences the evaporation activity, or in other words, the evapotranspiration activity as well, because evaporation and evapotranspiration, they are related. Is that clear? So, if you now look at the relative humidity in this context, what is relative humidity? The relative humidity is the ratio of EA to ES. Now, the way I think we were giving the nomenclature, we were calling the saturation vapor pressure as EA, and ED was known as the air, the actual vapor pressure of the air. The nomenclature has changed, I'm sorry for that. You can, for all practical purposes, you can resort to the same nomenclature, EA, if this is EA, and this is ED, this is EA, as per our previous nomenclature which we have been using. So, is the ratio between the actual vapor pressure and the saturation vapor pressure expressed in percentage. That is what is the relative humidity. Is that clear? Okay. Now, another thing which somebody had mentioned, and we were trying to, I was saying that there are other ways of expressing the function or the graphical representations which have been given in the last lecture. For example, in the case of Blaney-Criddle equation, we had used, for the correction factor, we had used ultimately one graphical representation. But there are ways and means by which you can avoid using those graphical relationships. You can instead, there are relationships available which can be directly used if you have all the parameters, they are observed, they are known, then you can avoid using. So in this particular case, there is another form of the Blaney-Criddle equation, which is similar. Earlier, I think in this place, this we had, this was the correction factor. Now in this particular case, and this instead of 8.13, it was 8.0. So that is the only difference. In this particular case, your A's, A and B, they are expressed further in terms of some other parameters. Example, A is expressed in terms of relative humidity minimum and the sunshine ratio and Bayan. And B is also expressed in terms of relative humidity minimum and Bayan and U day, the wind speed at 2 meters high in meters per second. So that is the daytime wind speed. These equations have been formed by using the regression analysis, and they can also be used, for example, in this particular case to find out the value of B. Either you can use this relationship, or there is another table which is provided. I have only written first part of the table. This table is extended. You have the values for UD of 2 meters per second, and this goes up to 10 meters per second. So there are four more tables of this kind. I'm not given the full table. Is the first part where you have the N by N ratio from 0 to 1. The relative humidity minimum is from 0 to 100, and U day 0 meters per second. Similarly for 2, 4, 6 and so on, those tables are available. So you can either use this table to write the varied the value of B and interpolate between if you have value of these parameters in between, or you can use directly this relationship and find out. So they are similarly in other situations, in other cases, in other formulas, there are the options available. You can use a simpler tabular form, or if you want to computerize, if you want to use a program, computer program, you might need equation which is much easier to use, and that can be resorted to. There's the values or the results which you get, they are quite similar. The percentage of error might be within 5%. Now we had started in the last class the Penman method, and we had said that the Penman method, what is the basis behind. We had mentioned that it has two terms. It does the energy balance as well as it includes the aerodynamic term, and that is why, since it takes care of both the options or all the influencing factors, because the influencing factors are, the radiation is one influencing factor, the other is the climate in terms of the wind conditions or the humidity level. Those two things, the predominance of those two things or those two items can change from place to place to place. So if you have an equation which can take care of both these major influencing elements, then you can certainly come out with the results which are quite close to the actuals, which are very realistic. The errors are minimized. This is the original Penman equation. which is almost similar to what the FU has recommended. And this term we are using as weighting factor W. This is a ratio between delta plus gamma, where delta is the slope of saturation vapor pressure versus temperature curve at T mean. Now this is the same curve which we have discussed just now, the psychrometric curve. And gamma is the psychrometric constant. So this is what makes the W, which we have used in our expression, which is recommended by FAO, is the same thing, only expressed in a different manner. This also has a term G, which is the soil heat flux. That soil heat flux is positive if soil is warming, otherwise it's negative. This controls what is the change of or the heat transfer from the soil into the atmosphere or vice versa. And this is the term which is the aerodynamic term, which was again it was there in the original Penman equation. And this term is nothing but as 1 minus W. If you take this is gamma delta divided by delta plus gamma, if you take 1 minus delta by delta plus gamma, that is what is here. And this is the vapor pressure deficit which you have just talked about. That is the difference between the saturation vapor pressure and the vapor pressure at the air temperature. This is the variation, which is very slight variation in terms of the difference between the original Penman equation and the modified one. And the modification, they have only given more emphasis on the C parameter, which is the adjustment factor, which is to compensate the conditions which have been assumed in the original Penman equation. So there are some situations, there are some conditions which can be prevalent in some areas which are not the same as have been assumed in the original Penman equation. So those conditions, when you take care of those conditions and you apply the correction factor, that is done through the correction factor C. Let's try to go through the various elements of this equation and try to look into how we compute those elements, how we calculate those elements, what are the various relationships available, what are the various requirements in terms of the basic data which is needed to compute these different elements of the Penman equation. So we'll start one by one. The first one is the vapor pressure deficit, which is Ea minus Ed. And since we know that this affects the air humidity, which in turn affects the Et naught, this deficit, how to compute this deficit in actual practice, there are many ways of doing the same. And the method to be adopted will be a function of what you have available, what type of data is available. Let's look at these different cases which can be possible or which can be used depending on what type of data you have available with you. The first case cases, when you have the data on maximum temperature, minimum temperature, the data on maximum relative humidity, and the minimum relative humidity. These are the various data which are available. Then you can use the relationship. You can find out what is the mean temperature. You can find out the mean relative humidity. And these are the examples. Example has been taken where the actual values have been taken just for assumption's sake. These are the values which have been shown here so that you can better understand the computations. So if you take the mean temperature is the mean of these two temperatures, the maximum and the minimum temperature. That is 28.5 degrees centigrade in this particular case. And the relative mean humidity. The relative humidity can also be found out by taking the mean of these two values, which is 55%. Now, the psychrometric table or the psychrometric curve which I have shown you just now, that is also available in the form of a table, because it is a unique curve, is an envelope curve, which is a universal curve. Now that give you the saturation vapor pressure at any temperature. So this is a table, which is the table between the temperature in degrees centigrade and saturation vapor pressure, EA, which gives for different temperatures what is the value of EA. Is this visible? Anyway, I mean, it's not important. I just in the support material which we are giving, you will have all these tables available. But suppose if this table is not available, you can still use this equation. Can be used. There's a relationship between the saturation vapor pressure and the mean temperature, and this relationship can be used to get the value of the saturation vapor pressure. Okay. Now this is an alternative to using the table, but this table is quite a easily available table. One can find in any standard resource material or the textbook. Once you find out the saturation vapor pressure, then the actual vapor pressure can be found out by using the relationship between the relative humidity and the vapor pressures. So relative humidity is ED by EA. You know the EA value, you can find out ED. You know the relative humidity, the mean relative humidity, you know. So ED can be found out. ED is 21.4 millibar in this particular case. So you can find out the deficit. There's one situation in which you have these data available and you can find out what is the saturation vapor pressure deficit. Let's look at another case where you have the data available on maximum temperature, minimum temperature, and the psychrometric readings. Do you know what a psychrometer is? It's a instrument which you use to observe the wet bulb and the dry bulb temperatures. Is something like there are different kinds of equipment which are in use. But the one which is aspirated means where you are you can use the ventilation. That's the one which is something like a rattler. You have a rattler where you have two thermometers. One is for the reading of the air temperature, and the other one is for the wet bulb, in which case you are taking a porcelain cloth, slightly wet it with water and wrap it around the second thermometer's bulb. Okay, so when you do that, what happens? It evaporates that moisture which is available in the cloth, the damp cloth, and that evaporation reduces the temperature because of the loss of the latent heat of evaporation. Okay, so when you lose that temperature, how much temperature you will lose will be a function of what is the, it'll be depending on what is the humidity level, what is the temperature. So that these two temperatures, the wet bulb temperature and the dry bulb temperature, these two temperatures are obtained from the psychrometric readings. There are different, there are other kind of psychrometers also which are not ventilated, which are not non-ventilated psychrometers, and that correction can be applied, because if you create that ventilation, it'll have more evaporation. If you don't create the ventilation, it might have less evaporation because of the fact that the air mass which is immediately closer to that wet bulb, which will be after some time, if it is laden with the soil, the water vapors, then unless that is replaced, that air is replaced, it won't be in a position to evaporate any further, because you have seen that in the case of air mass, the air mass reaches, let me give you an example. Suppose this is the body where the evaporation is taking place. So the water vapors, they go into this particular volume of air. Now this air mass, if it becomes saturated and this is not replaced by another air mass which is having less water molecules, then the evaporation activity will stop there, because this air mass has been totally saturated, and you know that at that particular temperature the air mass is not in a position to absorb any more vapors. So if you have, that is how the wind affects the evaporation. That is where the wind effect comes into evaporation. The wind influences the air mass which is absorbed with the water vapors to replace that air mass with a fresh air mass which might be having much less amount of water vapors. If that happens, then the evaporation activity will proceed at a very faster rate, at a very higher rate. Otherwise, the activity might stop after some time because of the higher level of humidity. Okay? So from that angle, if we have these dry bulb and the wet bulb temperatures available, then again you can find out what is the mean temperature, and you can also find out what is the saturation vapor pressure at that temperature, that is using that relationship or using that table. You can find out that there is a table which again it might not be visible to you. If I put it in this, if this can be enlarged, you might be in a position to see this part. There's a table between the vapor pressure and dry and wet bulb temperatures. Now, this is the dry bulb temperature here. Dry bulb temperature in degrees centigrade, which is given from 0 to 40 here. And on this side is the depression. Depression in the wet bulb. N degrees centigrade. What does that mean? The difference between the two. The difference between the wet bulb, the dry bulb and the wet bulb temperature. So this goes from 0 to 22 degrees centigrade. And this part of the table is for altitudes between 0 and 1000 meters. Whereas this part of the table is the same thing but for a different, for the altitudes between 1000 and 2000 meters. So you, if you know the dry bulb temperature and you also know what is the depression in the wet bulb, or what is the difference between the two, knowing these two and knowing what is the altitude of the location in which, at which you are applying this, you can read out what is the vapor pressure, the actual vapor pressure, ED. That actual vapor pressure can be directly read using this table. And this is for this for aspirated psychrometer. This table is for that. There is another table which is to be used in case you are using a non-ventilated psychrometer. There is a similar table which gives the vapor pressure with respect to the dry bulb temperatures and the wet bulb temperatures, but for a non-ventilated psychrometer. So knowing these two values, you can read the ED value, the vapor pressure at the dry bulb temperature and the wet bulb depression. In this particular case, the difference between the dry bulb and the wet bulb is 4 degrees centigrade. You are reading the value at dry bulb temperature of 24 degrees centigrade with a wet bulb depression of 4 degrees centigrade, and that value is 20.7 millibars, and you can find out the deficit. There is a third case where you might not have the data on psychrometric readings available. You might not have the relative humidity available, but you have instead, you have the dew point temperature, which is available. The data on dew point temperature is available along with the maximum and the minimum temperature. Again, the first two parts are the same, that you can find out using the mean temperature. You can find out the saturation vapor pressure. But to find out the ED, you can do that if your relative humidity of the area is close to 100%. You must have seen in this case where I was trying to explain the psychrometric curve. What happens in the psychrometric curve, which is this curve, if you know the dew point temperature, if this is the dew point temperature and this was the air mass, now if the relative humidity at that level is quite close to 100%, that is very likely that the two will the dew point temperature and the wet bulb temperature, they will be same. The dew point temperature will be quite close to the wet bulb temperature, and which will be approximately same as the minimum temperature. These three quantities, these three temperatures, provided the humidity level, the relative humidity is close to 100%. That means you are somewhere in the near vicinity. And in this particular case, it won't happen, because in this particular case, if this is my TD, then it's quite likely, because there is a lot of deficit is there, it's very likely that the relative humidity won't be 100%, because for the relative humidity to be 100%, what is the ED? This has to be, the ED has to be quite close to EA. The ratio of ED and EA has to be close to 1. So that means this deficit will be quite minimum. So the closer you are, if I am somewhere here, then the two will be quite close. The EA and ED will be quite close. Is it clear? So in that situation, this case, you can use this only in a situation where you have relative humidity which is close to 100%. In that situation, your minimum temperature, the wet bulb temperature and dew point temperature, they'll be quite close to each other. And if that is so, you can use the psychrometric curve to find out what is ED. So ED will be close to the saturation vapor pressure at the dew point. ED will be nothing but, in that case, ED will be nothing but the saturation vapor pressure at the dew point temperature. And once you have that, you can find out what is the deficit. So these are the various situations which can be utilized to find out the saturation vapor pressure deficit. Next, let's look at the wind function, which is used in the case of there's a wind function here, and this is part of the aerodynamic term. That wind function we have already looked at, EA minus ED. That is the next part which we are trying to look at right now. Now in this particular case, the wind function is expressed as this equation, as this expression, in which capital U is the wind run, the 24 hours wind run and kilometers per day at 2 meters height. In many cases, you might find that the actual observation of the wind speed, which is being done in the field, it might not be available at 2 meters height because of various reasons. The instrument which is installed, it might be installed at a height which is different from this standard 2 meter height which is to be used. Then for that, a correction factor has been recommended. You can use this correction factor, which is between the measurement height and at 2 meters, it is 1. If it is less than 2 meters, then a correction factor which is more than 1 has to be used. If it is more than 2 meters, a correction factor which is less than 1 which has to be used. Which is quite obvious, because if you are very close to the surface, there will be more resistance. the actual wind speed which you are measuring will be much less than the prevailing wind conditions. So the correction factor has to be greater than 1. On the contrary, if you are going above that, then again you might be overestimating the conditions, so you have to apply a correction factor accordingly. So this is again, this is the correction factor which is recommended by FAO. For the wind function, this is the table which is available, which gives the wind function with respect to that formula which we had just written, which is this 1 plus u by 100, okay, and this is the wind in kilometers per day ranging from 100 to 900, and on this side you have the fractions available. If it is 110, you can use this. This is from 10 to 90. So if it is between 100 and 200 and is some values which are between 0 and 90, you can use this table, and you can still interpolate if you have some value which is between 20 and 30. So the tens and the lower digits can be, and tens are given here, the lower digits can be interpolated. The next is the weighting factor, which is this factor 1 minus W. This weighting factor is to incorporate the effect of wind and humidity in the ETO. And again, there is a standard table which is available, which gives the values of the weighting factors 1 minus W, and this is the temperature from 2 degrees centigrade to 40 degrees centigrade, and the altitude is on this side from 0 to 4000. So for different altitudes and for different temperatures, you can read out the value of the weighting factor 1 minus W. Similarly, the weighting factor W, which is the component in the radiation term, this weighting factor is also related to the temperature and altitude, and this is a replica of the earlier table, the same thing, but is 1 minus the values of the previous table. So it's the same table with a slight modification, because the total weightage is 1. Whatsoever is the weightage given to the radiation term, the remaining weightage is given to the aerodynamic term. In many situations, you might, this is very simple if you are using these tables, but there are procedures available, there are expressions available where if you have the available data, you can use those required data and you can find out the weightages yourself by using the relationships directly instead of going to the tables. So if you are writing a program, you are writing a software, you might find that these relationships are much easier to model than to use those tables. The way we had defined the weightage factor W, this was the delta, slope of the saturation vapor pressure curve, and this is given in terms of this equation. Delta can be directly found out using the mean temperature of the air in degree centigrade, and the cyclometric constant is nothing but is the ratio between the vapor pressure deficit and the wet bulb depression. It can also be expressed in a simpler form, in which this P is the atmospheric pressure in millibars and L is the latent heat of vaporization. There are expressions available to find out what is the value of atmospheric pressure, and that is given in terms of these variables. P0 is the standard sea level atmospheric pressure, T0 is the standard sea level temperature, and this is in Kelvins. And delta is the standard lapse rate in Kelvins per meter. And R is the universal gas constant for air. This is 287 joules per kilogram Kelvin. G is the acceleration due to gravity. E0 is the base elevation in meters. And E is the elevation of the location in which you are interested. Similarly, there is an expression for latent heat of vaporization, which is a function of the air temperature, that can be used to find out L. Now, if you have these data which is required in this particular case, which means the data on all these variables, you can certainly use this expression for finding out the weightage factor yourself. Otherwise, you can, it's very convenient to use the tables. So there's no restriction. The tables can be used if you feel that the tables are much easier to be used, if your accuracy, because in that case you'll have to interpolate. And in some cases, it is recommended that the table should be preferably used, because all these equations where the regression analysis has been used, is the accuracy is not as good as you can get in the case of tables, because when you have used the regression analysis, the fit, the goodness of the fit is another criteria which has to be looked into. It depends how many data has been used, how many different conditions have been incorporated in doing those regression analysis, and what was the goodness of it. So I think is just a function of availability. If you have the data available, you can use either of the things with the slight loss of accuracy, but it'll be more dependent on where you are using, whether you are using in a system or you are doing it manually. So that'll be making the basic difference. And I think we can stop here for today. Any question? If